from the epistle. What then was gained by Abraham, our ancestor? In the name of God, amen.
Amen.
A refresher course. Let's have a sermon today about one of the old, old stories. It's the tale of one man and his extended family. Remember, don't you, the three linked names, Shem, Ham, and Japheth? Abraham is Shem's grandson. And that makes Abraham the great-grandson of Noah, who built the ark. I like to mention these things every now and then to sort of dimly locate ourselves within our own origin story. Genesis 12 includes this brief statement that a large extended family settled together, and they were acquiring more land, more cattle, and they were growing and extending their family. Then the Lord God spoke these words to Abraham, and he said, "Get you up, you and your wife Sarah and your nephew Lot," they had no children, "and all that pertains to them, and journey to the new land where I shall direct you, and I will bless you," he continues. "I will bless you, and the blessing from me will in the end bless all the nations on the earth." Now, looking at the epistle, it is plain that Paul is right in the middle of arguing with someone. The urgency of it is right there. He is defending the right of his non-Jewish Gentile converts to be in the church. What has this very concise statement of Abraham, our origin story, what has this got such overarching significance to St. Paul that he uses it as what he considers an unanswerable argument to defend his new converts? You know, an awful lot of people positively dislike St. Paul, including an awful lot of Christian people seem not to like Paul very much. But here's the reason a great many of the early Christians disliked Paul. Simply put, you all know that in the beginning, the entire church was entirely Jewish. Jewish Christians, week by week, would gather as the body of Christ around the table fellowship on Sundays. They declared that Jesus is the promised Messiah. They now read scripture with new eyes. Jesus Messiah was now seen all over the Psalms and the prophets. In addition, they continued to keep the whole of the Jewish law, including the kosher food laws, continued to keep the holidays of Moses, continued to worship each Saturday in synagogue and temple. Now, Paul took great pride in the fact that God had called him to preach the gospel among and to those outside the Jewish community. But his fellow Jews in this community, they felt it was only logical that any man wishing to join the church, and needless to say, we are talking only of men here, any man who wanted to enter the church, well, they should first undergo conversion to Judaism. The good church people wondered, could Gentiles even be members of a church that was founded by Jesus, a Jew, and by his Jewish disciples? Greeks and other Gentiles who had not worshipped at the temple on Saturday, they were not circumcised, they did not keep the food and the other purity laws. Is Paul really proposing that these unclean outsiders be allowed to gather on Sundays with us around the table of fellowship? So in today's epistle, Paul is solemnly warning his churches to beware of teachers who purposely put stumbling blocks in the way of these new converts. In particular, Paul is deeply worried that there are Christian Jewish teachers out there insisting that newly Christian Gentiles, converts, must now begin keeping the whole of the 600-something articles of the Jewish law that was given to Moses at Mount Sinai. Now, these Greeks and these other Gentiles, of course, they have not been raised in the law. It's never been part of their life, including the kosher food laws, and of course, this other one little thing. church membership, they undergo circumcision. Now to Paul, looking at all this, the refusal of his fellow Jews to give his converts the right hand of fellowship, this was an absolute turning upside down of the gospel. It infuriates Paul, really, so that he wrote in another letter, "Are you so soon forgetting the one who called you in the freely given grace of Christ? Are you so soon going back to rule-keeping and ceremonial exactitude, which perverts the message of freedom in Christ?" And the book is furious evident. In this letter to the Galatian church, in his other letter to the Galatian church, he literally writes to his converts, "I wish that those who are unsettling you over this would slip the next time they circumcise one of them and castrate themselves." Older scholars were a little more in awe of Paul than we are. And they rationalized this temper of his, which seemed to some of the Victorian clergy an egregious lapse. Here's one bishop. "A highly nervous and excitable constitution, such as Paul's, shattered by bodily hardships and mental strain, could not but at times impair his self-control. And indeed, this natural ardor was of great service in the spreading of the gospel." Why does Paul balance his entire argument with his fellow Jews upon the promise that God offered Abraham, and which Abraham accepted and answered? Some of you know Thomas Cato, Desire of the Everlasting. He says, "Abraham got up and went out." These two words, they are two words in Hebrew. He went out. These are the most significant two words in our history. Because to make his point, Paul wants them to remember who they are. He wants them to remember their origins. That promise that came to Abraham, that his relationship with God was a right relation, and that his descendants would be blessed. That promise did not come because of the law that Moses received at Mount Sinai. It did not come because Abraham and his family obeyed all the requirements of the law. How could it have? The law wasn't going to come along for another 450 years. No, as you can plainly see, Paul argues, Abraham attained his righteousness before he was circumcised. In other words, while he was still a Gentile, God pronounced that Abraham was in this right relationship not because of any ritual acts, or really, not because of any moral virtue, but because Abraham had heard God's voice, to which he then responded in this right relationship of trust and loyalty and obedience. Now this morning, Paul has written, if Abraham were being declared in right relationship with God because of his good works, well, then he would have something to boast about, wouldn't he? But the truth is that no one can make this boast, because there is no one who has kept the whole law, not in its ritual requirements, like keeping kosher, observing holy days, undergoing circumcision. No one keeps the ritual law perfectly. And no one keeps the moral code either. Things like thou shalt not gossip and bear tales, thou shalt not oppress the foreigner among you, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not steal. God's my life, there are entire nations and peoples that have turned themselves into moral cesspools. All people and all nations need salvation, need rescuing, need to be restored to right relationship with God. But not by first requiring moral perfection of us. A rotting and bending branch, that's certain to break. But by a way that is realistically open to all humans. That is, by responding in trust to the promises of God, especially which now find their yes in Jesus. Paul is also arguing God is not God only of the Jews. As he says, if only we Jews are to be the heirs of the promise, then the faith of other people is null and void. The promise Abraham received to bless all nations? No, no, he says. Paul says, there is one God for all human beings. And God is also fair. He's fair. He does not save only the one nation chosen to bear the Messiah while throwing all the other nations on the trash heap. God must make a way for all humans to be worthy to stand before him. All humans can enter a right relationship with their Creator by responding, yes. Dear Bishop Sheen, spiritual life, he says, is not pushed up from below with great vigor and effort. It is a gift that comes down from above. You can't do anything to achieve the new life. You can only say yes and begin living in the world as if you are one who has been born into the new life, newly born into the kingdom that is now coming right at us. The Lord said to Abraham, go from your country and from your kindred and from your father's house, called out of ignorance into awareness, out of error into truth. God called them out not to adopt a belief system. You might eventually adopt specific beliefs about him. God called them, but not to a special way of life, though you should get that eventually. He called them not to church. Oh, here we are. Here we are. And not even called to revere the Bible. You'll see the central place we did that. No, God did not come to condemn the world, but to suffer, as he told his friends, to suffer and to die, to offer himself as the one sufficient sacrifice, according to God's first testament, a way for all humans to turn from their wickednesses, large and small, and get back into this right relation with himself, get back into the relation of trust and loyalty and obedience. That's the sermon, but you know, I'd love to tell this part of the story. There is no wasted energy. You know this. There's no wasted energy, not for God. God has not endured the dangers of birth, being birthed, the pathology of adolescence, the shock of baptism and temptation. He did not endure the misery of everybody misunderstanding him, the public humiliation of stripping and flogging him. God, I'm glad the law in this country at least doesn't flog me off. The very belief, he did not endure the belief that he was abandoned by his father out there on the cross. The agony on the bloody sweat, the nails, the noonday heat. God did not consent to all that, simply to divide the people of this planet into winners and losers. That would be way too small a purpose for a deity. Far too small, entirely too puny, a little too much like ourselves and what we would do. Way too little for him to purpose, him whose word cannot be broken, cannot be thwarted, and not when